And so Merton had this article in 1968 in which he'd used the term Matthew effect to describe scientific careers. Herb Wahlberg talked about Matthew effects with respect to achievement in general, okay, including educational achievement, but also other occupational endeavors. And then I stole the term third hand, I guess, from Wahlberg and used it specifically as a term to model effects that are going on in the reading process itself, to embed the idea of cumulative advantage and disadvantage effects in a developmental model of reading. You have well-developed phonemic representations, hence you struggle less with the code, and your phonological decoding is good, so you recognize words well very early in your reading experience. If you recognize words very well, you have a lot of capacity left over for the high-level comprehension processes we were just talking about. If you have a lot of capacity for those, stories are interesting because you're thinking about them, and the stories are interesting, so you read more, and you read more, and you develop more of those decoding processes, and then interestingly, what I developed in the Matthew effects paper is even when let's say you get to further stages of reading where decoding processes are asymptoting and other types of high level inferential processes are coming online. Well, you have a built-in advantage there because all of this reading you've been doing has been building declarative knowledge. It's been building lexical distinctions. It's been building vocabulary, all of the things that you're going to need, let's say, post fourth grade as well.
This is a particularly important spot. You just went from Matthew effect into what reading does for the mind, as far as reading as a cognitive exercise environment for making the kind of distinctions and critical reflection and extension into vocabulary differentiation and into the world that we just don't do if we don't read.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I titled a paper, you know, "Does Reading Make You Smarter?" Precisely to provoke people to think about this. The conclusion of the paper was the answer is yes. If you default to what is pretty much a consensus view of intelligence. Certainly there are two really separable domains of intelligence, so-called fluid intelligence, abstract problem solving, and the so-called crystallized intelligence, okay, declarative knowledge, vocabulary, lexical distinctions, verbal facility. Now, since the Matthew effect paper, since some of the work that our group has done, but many other groups on the effects of reading, the effects of exposure to print, crystallized intelligence is just massively built by reading itself, okay? Independent of education, independent of fluid intelligence, okay? Regardless of what your levels of abstract problem solving are, you build declarative knowledge, you build lexical distinctions with reading, and reading is uniquely efficacious. Some work I always point to when I talk with teachers on this is by a psycholinguist by the name of Don Hayes. I think she mentioned this to you, where he's looked at what he calls the lexical density, okay, of text of various types, and in particular the distinction between oral language and written language. So if you take a transcript off a network television show, or the transcripts from, let's say, hospital waiting room conversation or whatever, you can compute indices of lexical rarity, and they're quite interesting statistical indices of, let's say, the relative rarity of a word. In 10,000 words or in 1,000 words, how many words will you encounter that are outside, let's say, the basic 5,000 word lexicon? Okay. And if vocabulary is going to grow after the fourth grade, necessarily you have to be exposed to such words. Well, how often is that going to happen in texts of various types?
What are different venues that children or adults may find themselves in, and which words that are uncommon to their native, to their common oral language, are going to occur enough for them to have any exposure and learn them?
That's exactly it. Well, and what Hayes has shown is that the factors is enormous. It's 5-1, 10-1, 20-1 that a written source is going to give you more of just those exposures. Okay. And so there's every reason to believe that print is uniquely efficacious on the side of crystallized intelligence. So if crystallized knowledge is part of your concept of intelligence, and it is for 90% of the theorists out there, then in fact reading does make you smarter.